Welcome to Crossroads Online. My name is Christy, one of the pastors here, and I'm so glad that you're worshiping with us today online. Before we get started, we'd love for you to take a moment and share this service with a friend or a family member. Just send them the link or share the video on Facebook. On the Crossroads app, you'll find what we call a communicator card. Let us know that you're here and how we can be praying for you this week. Let's begin our time with worship.
Thank you.
We're excited for this year's spiritual growth campaign called Made for More, and it's not too late for you to join us. We're walking through the book of Ephesians and learning how each of us is designed to play a key role in God's purposes here on the earth. The role that we're called to play may be more than we've ever dreamed of. Now, to get the most out of this six-week experience, we invite you to commit to weekly worship, either in person or online, to try a life group, and to spend time daily with God. This year, we have a devotional book called Made for More, and they're available for $5 at the Crossroads campuses or as a free ebook download on our website. I encourage you to sign up on the Crossroads app or at xr.church/more. I look forward to joining you in this journey through the book of Ephesians as we discover how we are made for more. Another thing that we have coming up is our IF conference. Ladies, this is for you. I want to invite you to this year's IF gathering on March 5th and 6th. Now, we'll be doing this a little bit differently and gathering in our homes. So invite a couple of friends or neighbors to gather with you in your home for the IF conference. The theme of those 2 days is going to be Even If. Even if the worst happens, we don't lose hope. Come join us as we remember that together. Everyone who registers through Crossroads will receive $10 off the price of your admission, and we'll have our own chat, so we'll be able to communicate as if we were physically gathered together. Sign up and register at xr.church/if. Your generous giving is what fuels the mission of Crossroads, to change the world by making disciples who make disciples. The easiest way to give is online at xr.church/give, or you can mail a check to the address on the screen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you just for all the ways that you are open-handed toward us. I pray, Father, just as we give this offering to you, Lord God, that it would just mirror you with open hands. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Let's continue to worship God together through singing and giving.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. gave us His one and only Son to save. For God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
So together as a church, we like to pray for the prayer requests that come in through our online communicator card. So today, let's just take a moment and pray for some of these. There's one request that says, I'm currently going through a difficult time and trying to navigate through some things that have been challenging. Let's pray for that. Lord God, we just pray for this person and lift them up as they're going through a difficult time. And Father, even though we don't know exactly what it is, we know that You do, Father. And so I pray right now that Your wisdom is generously poured out and that You guide and lead him, Holy Spirit. Another one is a couple that they've received some hard news about a pregnancy with their child. So together, let's pray. Father, we just lift up this couple to You, and I pray, Father, that this child would be healthy, that You would remedy the situation that's going on there. Lord, it says in Your word that we are formed in our mother's womb, and Lord, You do that perfectly. And so we pray, Father, for healing for this child in Jesus' name. Amen. And there's one more for a woman who is battling cancer. Lord God, we just lift this woman up to You right now. Father, You know her name. You know every situation that she's dealing with. Father, I pray over every cell in her body that You touch her and make her well in the name of Jesus. Now let's just have a silent time of prayer. We're just lifting people or our own needs to the Lord. Father, we just thank You that when we lift our needs to You, that You hear us and You care for us like a good Father. Father, we trust You with all of our life, and we give all of our life over to You. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Hi, my name is Steve Cordell, lead pastor at Crossroads Church, and welcome to this year's spiritual growth campaign. It's called Made for More, because we're looking at what the book of Ephesians tells us about how to step into the life that God calls us to. So if you have a Bible or an app today, you can turn to Ephesians chapter 1. I'm going to be reading from the New Living Translation today. So did you ever join a conversation that was already in progress and not understand what people were talking about? Or come in the middle of a story and not know what's going on? Well, my first ever official date with my wife, Linda, was to a newly released movie called Star Wars, A New Hope. And that was the first Star Wars movie to be released, but it was actually part 4 of the saga, which meant that we were coming in the middle of the story, literally. The filmmakers tried to bring us up to speed with the opening crawl, but still at the beginning of the movie, we didn't really understand what was going on. We're thinking, oh, why are the guys in the white armor storming that ship? And who's the guy in the black cape? And why is he breathing so loud? And what's the princess in trouble for? And what's she the princess of? So as the movie went on, we started to understand a little bit more about the role of the different characters in the movie. We understood that the stormtroopers in the white body armor were basically disposable extras, that the little robot droid on wheels would play a big role in this story. And in the next movie, we're all gasping when we learn that the guy in the black cape was actually Luke Skywalker's father. Now, if you're one of the few that has never seen Star Wars, you probably don't understand what I'm talking about right now, and that is my point. You see, to understand what's happening and who plays what role in a story, we need to know what's already happened. Now, you and I have joined an eternal story that is already in progress. This story is unfolding in real time, right now, all around us. It's God's story of His purposes on the earth. It's what He's doing right now in the world. And everyone in the world is born into this story, and some people are born again into this story. So the story started at the creation of the world. It reached its decisive turning point when Jesus rose from the dead, and it will continue and culminate when God recreates the heavens and the earth. Now, I'd say that the story has a happy ending, except that it's never going to end. So we need to know what's happening in God's story in order to understand the story of our lives and where we fit. If you've ever asked yourself, what's my purpose in life? Why am I here on the earth? Well, you're not alone. At some point, we all want to know why we are made. And if we try to discover why we're made by looking at ourselves, we'll never find the answer. But when we start by looking at God's story, then the meaning of our lives can fall into place. So to understand our purpose, we first need to understand God's purpose. What is God doing on the earth? And then what part am I to play? That's what this spiritual growth campaign is all about. So the book of Ephesians tells us that God has created us with a purpose in His story. And we all share this general purpose, and that is, we are made to do life with God. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 and 5 tell us, even before He made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in His eyes. God decided in advance to adopt us into His own family by bringing us to Himself through Jesus Christ. This is what He wanted to do, and it gave Him great pleasure. So let's let that sink in. Before there were oceans or an atmosphere on the earth, before there were trees or mountains, God chose us to be adopted as His children. And we were adopted. That means that once we were not His children, and now we are through faith in Jesus. John 1:12 says that when we trust in Jesus, we become children of God's family. So adopted children are chosen by their parents. Adoptive parents make a conscious choice to say, we want this child to be our son, to be our daughter. It's possible to have a child without planning it, but no one adopts a child by accident. It's an intentional choice. And verses 4 and 5 say, even before God made the world, He loved us and chose us. He decided in advance to adopt us into His own family. And that describes God's purpose for us, to love us, to bring us into His family. That's what His intent has been. So if you ask adoptive parents, why did you adopt this child? What's this child's purpose? They will look at you strange. I wonder why you'd ask such a question. The answer is obvious. We adopt this child to love him and for him to love us, you know, or to love her and for her to be part of our family so we can live together as a family. Now, God has adopted us for the same reason. Verse 5 says, this is what He wanted to do. and it gave him great pleasure. So it's very simple. It makes God happy to have you as a part of his family. I mean, we all put pictures of our family around where we can see them because it makes us happy to see them, to be reminded of them. So this is my home screen on my computer. This is my wife, Linda. It's taken when we were in Israel together. It's in front of Jerusalem there. And every time I open up my computer, I see her, and it makes me happy. And then Linda and I have pictures of our children and grandkids next to our fireplace so that when we're sitting in the living room, we can look over and see them, and it gives us joy every time we look at our family. Someone once said, if God had a refrigerator, your picture would be on it, because you are created to know him, to be in his family, and to do life with him. As I said in the Christmas Eve message, the main point of life is to do life with God. And so if we're not doing life with God, then we'll feel like something's missing because we're made for more. Sometimes we think that our purpose is to do a particular task, some kind of mission, some sort of job for God. But that's not really fully true. I mean, partly, but not fully. Because we're not made primarily to do things for God. God did not create you because he needed some staff to get things done. He created you to be his son or daughter. That's what Ephesians 1 tells us. From the beginning, his intent was that we be his children, to be a part of his family. That's the foundational event. That's the foundational purpose. So, we're not created simply to work at a certain company or to do a certain job. We're here to work that job with God. We're not here just to raise a family. We're here to raise a family with God. We're not here just to help the poor or to solve societal problems or to have fun. We're here to do those things with God. Being with him is the point. Now, because we are children of his and his family members, we also get included into God's purposes in the world. As verses 9 and 10, they refer to this plan. It says that God has now revealed to us his mysterious will regarding Christ, which is to fulfill his own good plan. And this is the plan. At the right time, he will bring everything together under the authority of Christ and everything in heaven and on earth. That's where history's going. That's where God's story is moving towards. Philippians 2 says, every knee shall bow, every tongue proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's where history's going. All governments and businesses are going to one day acknowledge Jesus as Lord. Even the communities, the families that we live in, all will acknowledge Jesus as Lord. The oceans and the weather will reflect Jesus as Lord. Everything in creation will acknowledge Jesus is Lord. That's where history is moving. And as his children, we get to be part of that plan. We are called to be participating in God's purposes on the earth. Now, Ephesians chapter 2 is going to tell us more about our calling and how it fits our purpose, but we'll look at that next week. Today, we'll look at Ephesians 1 and see that it tells us that our primary purpose is to do life with God, and it describes a little of what life with God looks like. 10 years ago, almost to the day, I had a cardiac arrest while working out of the gym. I had heart bypass surgery just a few days after that, and when I was waking up after the surgery, Linda, my wife, was there. Now, I didn't know she was there for a while. I was still coming out of the anesthetic. But when I started to regain consciousness, I realized that she was holding my hand. I could just feel that grip. And I couldn't get my eyes open for a while to see her, but I heard her voice, and I felt the grip of her hand in mine. And then, after a little while longer, I was able to briefly open my eyes, and I could see that she was there. She was there the whole time, I just didn't know it the whole time. Jesus promised, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. And he is always with us. Sometimes we're not aware of it. Sometimes we are. If we're going to do life with God, we need the eyes of our hearts opened to the reality that God has us in his grip. And that's just what Paul prayed for the Ephesian believers. He said in verses 18 and 19, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That's Paul's prayer for the Ephesians. And just by the way, it's a prayer I've prayed for you from time to time as well. These verses are important because they describe what life with God looks like. What does it look like when we do life with God? Well, first, when we do life with God, we approach today with hope. Ben Roethlisberger has been the Steelers quarterback for 17 years, and he led them to a lot of wins, including two Super Bowl victories. And over his career, he's led the Steelers to 35 comeback wins, 46 game-winning drives in his career. That means as long as Big Ben was in the game, you could never count the Steelers out. Now, as long as we know that God is with us in our lives, we will have hope no matter what we're facing. Paul prays for the eyes of our hearts to be opened, verse 18, that you may know the hope to which he has called you. So, if our eyes are on the pandemic, for example, we might get discouraged and lose hope. But when our eyes are open that Jesus is with us, we have hope for the future. If our focus is on the polar vortex or a conflict at home, we can get discouraged. But when we know that God, who rules over all of the weather and all the elements, and that God is with us, we'll have hope. When we live today with God, then hope can grow in us. No matter what situation we're in, we can have hope because the God who is with us has given so many amazing promises, and we know he'll fulfill them. See, when we face a challenge, there will be a promise for it. If we're facing a situation that doesn't seem to have a good answer, God promises wisdom in James 1. If we're mourning a loss and grieving, God promises to comfort us in Matthew 5. If we're facing death, we can have the hope of heaven because Jesus said in John chapter 14, verses 1 to 3, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Nothing can defeat the promise and our purpose of living life with God, and eternity is life with God forever. So I don't know what you're facing today, but I pray that the eyes of your heart will be opened to know the hope that you have because God is with you. Now, something else when we do life with God is that we can claim our inheritance. When the Landau brothers' mother passed away, they inherited the contents of her house. They boxed some of it up and they stored it in their basement. And one of the items was a painting which had hung in their grandfather's house for years and years. It was a picture of a woman who was passed out on a chair. Now, when the brothers decided that they wanted to set up a ping pong table in the basement, they needed to clear out some space, so they decided to sell all the boxed items, including the painting. And at the estate auction, bidding on the painting quickly accelerated. They were shocked when the bidding went way past the estimated $800 they thought it might bring. It went into six figures. And then finally, that painting sold for $1.1 million. It turns out the painting was an early work from the Dutch master Rembrandt. And the Landau brothers had no idea that they had inherited such a valuable piece of art. Now, we don't realize either what we've inherited from God, our Heavenly Father. That's why Paul prays that the eyes of our hearts would be opened, that you may know the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people. Because we're his children, we get to receive what's his. Now, we can't know today all that God has in store for us as his children. I mean, 1 Corinthians 2:9 says, what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things God has prepared for those who love him. Wow, most of the amazing inheritance that we'll have will be revealed when we're face-to-face with God in heaven. Although we can discover other parts of our inheritance as we follow Christ right here and right now. So in Ephesians 1:14, just a few verses early, it says the Spirit of God is the guarantee that he will give us the inheritance he promised. The Holy Spirit is given to us as part of our inheritance. When we choose to follow Christ, the Holy Spirit takes up residence in us. That means God himself comes to dwell in us, and that is the greatest inheritance of all. He gives himself to us. When my father passed away a few months ago, I reflected on what I inherited from him. It wasn't money. It was some physical traits, sure, but so much more. From a value of clear thinking, I got that from him. For an appreciation of fine music, I got that from him. And respect for all kinds of peoples and cultures from around the world, I got that from him as well. Those and many other values shaped me. I would not be who I am today without the legacy that he left me through who he was. When we do life with God, we are starting to receive our rich inheritance because he becomes our treasure. He imparts himself to us as we do life with him. Now, finally, when we do life with God, we can tap God's great power. One of the most popular ads of the 2011 Super Bowl was a Volkswagen commercial featuring a little kid dressed up as Darth Vader. He was attempting to use the power of the Force around the house. This is what it looked like. So just as that little kid could do nothing without his father's involvement or help, we can do nothing apart from the power of our Heavenly Father at work in us. And God makes his power available to us lavishly and abundantly. As Paul prays in verse 19, he prays that you may know his incomparably great power for us who believe. Nothing compares to God's great power. It can raise the dead, and it's available to us. So we don't need any more power. We just need to be aware of the power we already have in God. When we say, I can't, God says, I can. And as we do life with God, we'll approach every day knowing that whatever faces us, we're going to invite God's power to be at work in it. It won't be just our own efforts at work. It'll be Jesus' power at work in our lives. You are made for more than just existing, just making it to the next weekend or vacation. We're made to do every day of our lives with God. And every one of us can be successful in life because we can all fulfill our purpose of doing life with God. No matter our income level or nationality or appearance, we can all do life with God and treasure him above all. Let's pray. Lord God, we pray you would continue to open the eyes of our hearts, that we might see you for who you are and the treasure you are to us, that we would treasure you above all. And we pray, Lord, for you to open our eyes to the hope we have today, to the inheritance, the riches that we have in you in Christ Jesus, and the power that you make available to us through your Holy Spirit. I pray, Father, that you would help us today, this week, and the days ahead to be able to reflect your love and glory to others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Days may be darkest, but your light is greater. You light our way, God, you light our way. When evil is rising, you're rising higher with power to save, with power to save. You keep hope alive. You keep hope alive from the beginning to end. Your word never fails. You keep hope alive because you are alive. Jesus, you are.
So glad you joined us for worship today, and we'd love to pray for you. You can message us on Facebook or live chat our website with someone on our prayer team, and we will pray for your request. And we'd love to hear how God answers that prayer as well, if you want to let us know. Now, as people who are beloved children of the Father, sons and daughters, you are filled with His love and power. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.